dead, healed the sick. He done multiple miracles, Elijah and Elisha. But here the Bible gives this powerful man's name and says that Elijah died and they buried him. And you look at here, amen, it says that they buried him. It said the band of Moabites invaded the land of the coming of the year. And see, this is something that took place all the time. Every year the Moabites were coming to the land and they were raped and they were robbed of people. Every year they would take, they were coming to the city and take things that didn't belong to them. And the people of the city were used to this. This was like an annual thing where they got raped and got robbed and things were taken from them. But I want to let you know something, that God, amen, hears our prayers. And the thing about it is, when God sends a deliverer, amen, it may not be who you think it is. Because in the Jewish people, amen, they were looking for a deliverer, but they weren't looking for Jesus, really not the way he came up. They were looking for Jesus to come with a sword, amen, and a blade and start cutting up folks that was not into Judaism. But Jesus came as a lowly lamb. But here you find that the year that Elisha died, the Bible said the Moabites, they were coming, amen, to raid the land. But I'm here to tell you, in this little two verses, you're going to see a miracle. You're going to see the power of God, the resurrection power of God, and you're going to see the love of God.
That's right.
Here, the year that Elisha died, it said again, the Moabites came. But then it said there was another man that died.
Yes.
My God.
Note something here. His name wasn't even important enough to them to put down in the obituary.
All right.
Note that his name wasn't mentioned. His family name wasn't there. There was nothing good said about him. Amen. It was just somebody. Amen. We call him the insignificant man. So insignificant, again, that the Bible, amen, whoever wrote this did not even take time to find out who they were talking about. But they remembered this insignificant man because this insignificant man had some significance. Amen. That took place in his life. The Bible said he died. Well, dying wasn't significant. Everybody's going to die sometime. So that wasn't it. The fact that he died not too long after Elijah, probably 2 months after Elijah, because we know one thing, that Elijah had been dead long enough that nothing was left but his bones.
All right.
My God.
So he was buried at least 2 to 3 months after Elijah, and this is significant. Here, this man that had no name, they said they was carrying him, and they were carrying him to be buried. Thank God for small favors.
Yes.
At least they were going to put him in the ground. But look what happened. When they see the Moabites coming, the Bible said they seen them coming and said, we got to get rid of this dude. Because we can't run carrying him. Hello. He's too much of a weight. You'll find that a lot of times people feel like they can't handle you because you are a weight in their lives. We the people of God got to recognize when God has called you into ministry, he'll give you strength beyond your natural strength.
Yes.
That God will help you. And then praise God to do what he has called you to do. The Bible teaches us that God won't put no more on you than what you can bear. But these men thought they couldn't bear this unknown man's name. They couldn't carry him and run at the same time. So the Bible teaches us that they just threw this man's body down. One part said they let him down. But boy, this was a rough letting down. Then, you know, you go to a funeral, they let him down a little teeny bit at a time. A couple of inches at a time.
Yes, sir.
Please, they didn't have time for that. They seen the Moabites coming again. They just boom, boom. And I thought that was enough to whip them. But look at this story again. Because we're talking about the insignificant man. It says when the man was let down, he touched the bones of Elisha. Now, I bring something out that it did not say that he touched the flesh of Elisha.
That's right.
Elijah did not have any flesh on his bones. This was crucially important because the Bible teaches us that no flesh will get any glory in the sight of God.
All right.
God waited till all the flesh was gone off of Elijah's bones. Because there's a time in your life and in the life of God that God said, look here, Elijah done some things, and Elijah got the credit. But there comes a time when God says, I'm going to get the glory, because God is a jealous God. God waited till Elijah had no flesh on his bones, because no God did not want anybody to say, look what Elijah done. In order for you to allow God to use you, you got to get flesh out the way.
Yes, sir.
When we begin to look at what's going on in the world, there is just so much flesh in the house of God. Amen. When we look at how we carry ourselves, the way we dress anymore, flesh has gotten all in the way. God said, look at here, Elijah, I thank you for the 30 or so miracles that you've done, but this time I need you down to the bone.
Yes, sir.
I need you to get to where there's nothing about you.
Yes, sir.
And this is symbolic of how God and where God wants to take us. He wants to get us to a point in our life that we can look and say, look, it's not about me.
That's right.
Amen. You know that half the people in the church now want to get paid.
All right.
And I'm not against getting paid for certain things.
Yes, sir.
When you do it as a ministry and you're faithful and you're dedicated and you're on time.
Absolutely.
Hello. Amen. There's nothing wrong with that.
Yes, sir.
But anymore, you got folks want to get paid, and as soon as they do their job, they're out the church.
Yes, sir.
Hello. You got to love doing what you're doing, whether you're paid or not.
That's right.
Hello.
Absolutely.
Amen. You got to love it. You got to love God enough, and then that even if you don't get what you deserve, you still love doing the work and the will of God.
Yes, sir.
Amen.
Amen.
Here, this insignificant man more than likely never preached a sermon, never laid hands on nobody, never told anybody, God bless you, more than likely. He wasn't a prophet. He wasn't a preacher. He wasn't nobody's pope, nobody's evangelist. Again, he was just some insignificant man. But the fact was that we like here that God looked at this insignificant man, and he could have chose all kinds of people, amen, to be a hero in this story. But God said, I'm not using Samson. Amen. He's just too big and too strong.
Yes,
I need somebody with no name, no muscles, no strength, no ID, no nothing. And I'm going to show my glory in his life. And this is the thing that sometimes we look at ourselves, I want you to know, when you don't have a title, don't have a name, when you don't even have a history of doing a whole lot in the church, you're just in the place where God can use you.
All right. I know.
Because every day God is still using insignificant people.
Yes, sir.
Well, let me look at here. Elijah had no flesh on his bones. That was one thing. But let's talk about the big man. God didn't want him necessarily to get the glory, even though God wanted to use him.
Yes, sir.
He didn't want him to get the glory. Here, we note that this man was being buried. And when you study the burial at that time, what they did, they wrapped the bodies up. They mummified them. They wrapped them from foot to their head. Totally wrapped up. And this was very significant. Let me bring this up. Take my time. Very significant that you understand now. You're talking about a man that's dead being totally wrapped up. This is crucial. I'm looking at everybody. I want you to understand. This man was totally dead. Wrapped up. I mean, they done all the final breathing tests to make sure he's not alive. I'm quite sure to put a mural or something shining in front of his nose, make sure that this man is dead. This man was grabbed up. He wasn't dead. He's dead now. He's a little smothered. Hold on. So if he wasn't dead, we know he's dead now. Amen. That's a sad fact, because we know that some people are in a coma and not moving even harder than anything. But back then, they didn't know about a coma. That if you weren't moving, they called that dead.
Yes,
they just grabbed you up and now you are dead. Hello.
Yes,
amen. But today, you know, people have been laying in a coma. Their heart's barely beating, but they're still alive. And thank God for that technique, because I'm quite sure that a lot of people woke up one day in the ground. And that's a fact.
Woke up in the ground.
But look here. But let's talk about the greatest miracle in these two little verses here. You know, that makes me think about something, Lord. I'm very humorous. When I was young, they used to tell us, don't go in the graveyard because you hear somebody crying out there hollering. When I got older, I said, somebody probably didn't hear, they could have heard somebody. And then, because back then, y'all, again, they just buried us folks. And then man, we didn't get a whole bunch of autopsies and tell we got liberated. It wasn't a whole lot of fuss going over how you died. They just said another Negro day. That's it. Hello. Amen. I don't want to talk about it. Just another black person day. Amen. So if you was in a coma, they wasn't spending no money on you to see if you were breathing or not. Amen. Just one down and three more million to go. Amen. But here was a man that was seen to be down and out. He was buried. Or he was another, excuse me, he was wrapped up, tied up. But God says, now I got all the right pieces. I don't know how many of you in here play chess. I'm a chess player. I love to play chess. And you know, I